North Carolina, and we were 20 in summer school. When I heard her laughing down the hall, such a fine laugh, so husky and hearty a laugh, I just came running. Well, we found that we had lots in common, like music, drinking, and talking dirty, warbling, chortling until dawn. Self-conscious friends, but sincere, making bad jokes about suntan and natural rhythm that we thought we'd invented. And we had a grand old time, freaking out our mothers, threatening to blatantly bring our new friend home. And over very long beers in very dark bars, we get kinda mushy and symbolic, holding up our hands side by side. We'd marvel at our contrast, sharing drunken dreams of a future when it would not matter. But in the corners of our hearts and our minds, I know we kept a tally of the telltale signs that showed that though my intentions seemed fine, I was still my friend's oppressor. And under the very white southern blaze, she told me of the boy she loved. Never touched, really. But then I never touched anyone, really. Then came our final day in the rich red August afternoon, and there we were just standing in my room, writhing in the silence apart. Suddenly we ran into each other's arms, swaying, swooning in the fierce tenderness of a moment. Then suddenly I was possessed by the reflex of a lesson learned too well, an old lesson that touches blow. Only touch the one you know to be your lover. And so I panicked, and I stiffened, and I jerked away. And in the aching fierceness of the moment, her very black knew that that aborted embrace negated all we'd shared. But I was locked in silent shock, and she walked away forever. Oh, Rosalind, what kind of world is this that twists and tears our mightiest moment, that forces me to forsake our struggle for another left unspoken, that surely makes you see my act only as a last betrayal, that makes me assume that I was alone in the fear at being queer?